The process of shooting the video for this anthem is the most epic video production process I have personally been involved with.
It's amazing. Who would think that we can use the culture in such a manner?
Fort Charlotte was amazing. I didn't expect it to turn out so huge. It makes me wonder, where am I going to be in 40 years? And how far is this anthem going to go?
I think of it more as a vision statement for our nation.
The FNM refuses to pay a bill at Government House.
What, is this a threat to democracy?
The U.S. government shutdown continues, and so does the discussion on its possible impact on the Bahamas. Today marks the first National Heroes Holiday. We'll talk more about that. Plus, October is also Sight Awareness Month. I'm Nakia DeVoe, and this is NB12. Thanks for joining us here at Cable 12 Studios. Here are the stories coming out of the NB12 newsroom. The Free National Movement is refusing to foot that nearly $2,500 bill for the swearing-in ceremony and reception for FNM Senator Carl Bethel. The FNM is calling government's inability and unwillingness to cover the charge a slap in the face of democracy. Paige McCartney spoke with party leader Dr. Hubert Minnis today about his stance. Here's that report.
Minnis said he has instructed the FNM treasurer not to pay the bill, adding that if government can't afford state obligations and traditions, then it must curb public spending so that it can. The party invited 100 guests to attend the swearing-in ceremony and reception at Government House last week Tuesday, but was only told the day before that because Government House had no money to host the reception, the party would have to foot the bill. Senior party members said they have not been asked to pay for such occasions at Government House before. The party leader said for the FNM to be asked to pay for something that has in the past been taken care of by the state is overt victimization.
We think it's a form of victimization. Constitutionally, we're allowed so many senators. It's always been the process where they're sworn in at Government House, after which there is a reception. That has been paid for by the state. As you know, the senator, the opposition senator, his job democratically is to ensure that democracy maintains so that they can keep government's feet to the fire, transparency, democracy within the country. The people come to help celebrate and congratulate the new senator.
According to an invoice from Government House given to the FNM, food charges totaled $1,022. Rental charges totaled $500. Beverage charges came up to $876, and per diem charges totaled $75, to come up to $2,474 in total. Minnis said, what's most insulting is that just days after being told the FNM would have to pay for its own reception because of budgetary constraints, Government House hosted an even larger ceremony to sign off on two new public holidays. Minnis said he plans to reach out to the Prime Minister and Minister of Finance asking for a public explanation.
I'm sending a letter to the Prime Minister as Minister of Finance asking for an apology that we do not feel it's constitutionally correct that the FNM should be asked to pay for such an event when that is the swearing in of our new senator, whose job is to help maintain democracy and who will be fighting for the people.
Minnis said, moving forward, government should put a policy in place so that political parties aren't faced with this problem again in the future.
A policy moving forward where they can decide that events, swearing in, etc., the government will cover up to 100-150 individuals. In excess of that, the given party, be it PLP, FNM, or whatever, would pay beyond that. So if you want 1,000 people, that is fine. We know that the policy going forward for both organizations is 150. And beyond that, you are responsible. We would know that, the public would know that, and this type of thing that we're seeing today would not happen in the future.
Minna said this incident shows the government is overspending recklessly on things like hiring retirees and consultants and paying for Foreign Affairs Minister Fred Mitchell and his team to travel unnecessarily. Reporting for MB12, I'm Paige McCartney.
Minister of National Security Dr. Bernard Nottage is back in a South Florida hospital for a follow-up to a medical evaluation he had back in May. At the time, it was said that his illness was not life-threatening. The Bainstown and Grantstown Member of Parliament was treated at the Cleveland Clinic Hospital in Weston, Florida for an unknown medical issue. Nottage was accompanied by his wife and police aide during the last visit. When asked how he felt shortly after his return from medical leave in June, Nottage said he was feeling fine. Now, Dr. Nottage is expected back in the country shortly. In the meantime, Prime Minister Perry Christie will assume the responsibilities of National Security Minister. The U.S. government shutdown is into day 14, with no indication of when it will end. Meantime, U.S. Congress has until Thursday to raise its debt ceiling, or that country could default on its debts. Deputy Prime Minister Philip Davis says the government is definitely concerned about the impact this lagging standoff will have on the country. He says they're hoping members of the U.S. Congress can iron out their issues.
It's often said that when they sneeze, we catch a cold. And so we are a bit concerned that.
Last week, financial analyst James Smith warned that the shutdown could have negative effects on the Bahamian economy. He told NB12 he expects a fall-off in visitors in the first quarter of 2014. According to Smith, uncertainty in the U.S. economy will harm our country's tourism industry. But while the deputy prime minister says it is concerning, Davis told reporters he believes the Bahamas will be able to survive the lag thanks to strategic planning.
We think that we, with the fiscal prudence that we are now exercising, have been exercising, we'll be able to weather whatever the eventual outcomes of that will be.
It's been 2 weeks since the U.S. Congress failed to approve appropriation bills that would keep the U.S. government funded beyond the fiscal year end on October 1st, causing the government to shut down numerous agencies and sending over 800,000 of the federal government's 2.1 million civilian employees home without pay. The failure of the spending bill to pass came as Republicans, intent on derailing President Barack Obama's flagship health care law, sought to make the unwinding of this legislation a condition of passing the budget.
Congress and the senators and the President of the United States will work out the issues that keep them apart so that their economy could be settled and somehow become stable. The looming issue of their debt ceiling, the fact that the government shut down without them paying and they're being able to pay their meet their obligations is of concern to us, and we are watching it closely.
Smith said that even if the standoff is resolved before the end of October, the Bahamas could still feel repercussions. He fears the wrangling over the raising of the U.S. government's debt ceiling will have spillover effects for the Bahamas. The former state minister for finance also expressed concern over the impact of foreign direct investment. Well, Minister of State for Investments Kailas Roll says the Bahamas hasn't felt any effects from the U.S. government shutdown just yet. He says it's business as usual when it comes to foreign direct investment into the Bahamas.
We're anticipating that this sequestration will take place for another couple of weeks, and then we'll begin to see the U.S. back on track again. But if it's protracted, then we will become more concerned. But as it exists today, we haven't seen any major impact to the Bahamian economy, particularly as it relates to foreign direct investment. Investments that we've been courting and that is currently on the drawing board are still progressing as normal.
And even if the standoff lasts much longer than the Bahamas government hopes, Roll says he doesn't expect any major impact to foreign investments. He believes the focus placed on other markets will reduce the impact that could take place as a result of the activities in the United States.
We don't put our eggs in one basket. We are courting the Far East. You know, we're going to Dubai in a couple of weeks, and I have several meetings, major meetings lined up. You know, there's a group that has major plans, and they've already purchased assets that will support those plans. And we also have a trip scheduled to Canada. And Canada has been a major source of foreign direct investment for us, and we anticipate that over the next couple of weeks that we're going to see more interest in the Bahamas from Canadians.
Foreign Affairs Minister Fred Mitchell said Saudi Arabia, Qatar, and the United Arab Emirates are looking at various countries for investments and projects, and the government is in the process of further negotiations with those countries. Well, today is the first ever National Heroes Day. Coming up after the break, a discussion with a Bahamian who has made significant contributions to the country.
But there have been many interesting moments.
But first, we'll talk about the importance of the holiday and the National Heroes Act.
And there can only be a few persons ever named to that order.
Stay with us. NB12 will be right back after this.